Welcome to the Oncology Podcast. If you enjoy today's edition and would like to subscribe, head over to oncologynews.com.au and subscribe to our newsletter for regular podcast updates and a weekly review of the oncology news from Australia and around the world.
Hi, this is Rachel Babin from Oncology News Australia. I'm really pleased to share the first in this series of podcasts with you. Today, I'm talking with Professor Eva Segalov about cancer and COVID-19. Eva is a medical oncologist and director of oncology at Monash University and Monash Health. She is lead author of the paper Practical Considerations for the Management of Cancer Patients During the COVID-19 Pandemic. Please see the link to the paper in our notes. Eva has an interest in academic clinical trials in GI and breast cancer and has been a member of the AGITG since 2003. Thanks for listening. Hi, Eva. Thank you for joining me today to discuss this important issue. A lot has changed in the last few weeks and will continue to do so as the virus spreads and lockdown measures take effect. I'd like to start by asking you what you think the primary challenge for oncology services will be during the pandemic.
Thanks, Rachel, and thanks for the opportunity to talk on a podcast that hopefully will be widely listened to, because there's a lot of focus on public health, which is important, obviously. But for our patients who face all the challenges of somebody without a major illness, plus all the issues relating to their cancer, whether they're on treatment, what their outcome will be, how they will be treated if they do get COVID. So I think the biggest challenge for cancer services is firstly the same challenge as everyone. Will the hospitals be overwhelmed and we will actually not even be working as cancer doctors anymore? How to keep ourselves safe, how to keep our patients safe. But we are hoping to flatten the curve. And flattening the curve means we'll have our hospitals with capacity, not only to look after COVID-19 patients, but also to continue to care for our cancer patients in the same way we would without an epidemic, with some very important adaptations.
What are you advising colleagues to be aware of when treating patients? Are you expecting patients to present with common symptoms of COVID? Cough, high temperature, difficulty breathing?
So there's lots of aspects to that question. And one of the reasons we wrote the paper was that immediately there were discussions and many questions going around. And in everyday practice, but let alone unprecedented times, we rely on our colleagues and consensus opinion and people sharing information. And so the paper came about because we thought that we should have some sort of consensus and some sort of guidelines, not obviously telling anyone what to do. Obviously, every patient is different, every treatment decision is different, but there are some broad themes. And the paper goes through these and makes suggestions. What we've found in the international literature is there's quite a lot published at a very high level on those principles. Every patient is different. Think about a personalised decision. But there's not a lot of guidance of what that should be. And so our paper was particularly looking for less experienced oncologists or less experienced doctors or whoever's going to look after our patients in this pandemic if we can't flatten the curve and we are overwhelmed, that there are some principles of guidance. And we went through by different tumour types and different types of patients. So there's many, many aspects to that question. The first is that many patients that we have will have symptoms that may look like COVID but will be other things related to the cancer. And particularly patients on immunotherapy can get a dry cough, can have changes on their scan that looks very similar to COVID. So it's very important to have the history of what treatment the patient's on and what is the timing, because the treatment is entirely the opposite of COVID. And so we really need to get this right, and we need to have oncologists there very, very closely working with emergency physicians and others to make sure that patients are not, who look like COVID, that we're not missing actually it's something to do with their cancer or their cancer treatment. That is the same with the patient with a fever. So if you are healthy and you have a fever and cough, you still probably don't have COVID. You might have the flu or something else. But if you are a cancer patient on treatment, it's very important that we know what your white blood cells are and check that you don't have an infection related to having suppressed immune system from chemotherapy. So there are more, it's more likely in a cancer patient with a fever, depending on their circumstances, and this will change as the pandemic continues and increases and there's more community spread. But at the moment, the chance is more that if a patient with cancer has fever, it's not COVID, and we need to make sure patients don't miss out on treatment that they need for non-COVID disease.
Yes, of course. And do you envisage that any treatments will be delayed and surgeries cancelled because of this?
So again, there are two aspects to this. There is the capacity aspect, and we've seen overseas many health systems being overwhelmed, and we know in those systems that even important surgery like cancer surgery had to be delayed. And if the system is very overwhelmed, even chemotherapy and routine cancer treatment wasn't being given in some places. But the second thing is that this is a huge opportunity for us to keep our patients safe. And there are two main things we need to consider. One is the treatment itself. Are we making patients more exposed to getting COVID or to having a bad outcome if they get COVID? And even if the treatment itself is not doing that, by requiring the patient to come into the hospital for treatment or for tests or for visits, we are potentially exposing them, and they and their family are potentially exposing healthcare workers. So there are a number of steps that we really need to do straight away, and by and large they're all being done, and that is switching to telehealth and also revising people's treatment in conjunction with them, but seeing if we can reduce the intensity of the treatment or reduce the frequency of the treatment or have a treatment break, in fact, or use alternate treatments like tablets that we wouldn't normally use. So there's a large amount of things that we can do, making sure patients have had their flu injection, and oncologists and doctors as well. And we need to really come to terms with quite a different paradigm. When we have our patients, usually the cancer is their biggest problem and their biggest risk of dying is from the cancer, and that's why they're getting treatment. And all of a sudden, that almost out of the blue, we have this huge other, what we call a competing risk of death. You're more likely to die from COVID, perhaps, than from your cancer. And so in that scenario, we have to reevaluate your treatment and see if there is another option or a different way of doing it that we didn't need to consider before.
Yes, and I think that does bring us quite nicely into telehealth and how we might utilise that, how we might adapt to try and deliver services as safely as possible, where they are needed, as you say.
So I think that, again, there's multiple aspects. One is the safety of the patient and their family, and the other is the safety of all the healthcare workers, not just the doctors, but the nurses, the clerks, the cleaners, everybody involved when you have an in-person clinic. A video conference is actually a very suitable replacement for almost all circumstances. The technology can bring in family from different locations, can bring in an interpreter as well. Many patients might be scared of the technology, but I hope most systems being used are really very easy for the patient. They have to click on one area. We've had a little bit of reluctance from patients because they're worried about technology, or patients who don't may not even have a mobile phone or a computer or non-English speaking. And for those patients, we're trying to use the telephone, but that is a lot harder and a lot of the nuance of the consultation is lost. So the video is a very important part of the consultation, and that technology is being rolled out. And in some ways, this opening up of communication will be easier for patients. Patients who were sick often didn't want to come and travel for their visits. Now we can beam into their home when they're sick. So I think after this pandemic, we will have a lot of legacies left, and more use of telehealth will certainly be one of those.
We're quite worried about the implications of the pandemic, but immunocompromised patients with cancer are going to be particularly anxious. Is there anything in terms of general advice you could offer to patients of what they should be aware of, how they should communicate with their team, and how they can manage their fears?
Yes, absolutely. There are things you can do. The number one is to stay at home, except for those times where they need to make medical visits. But really, the cancer patient should be sending someone else, not themselves, to the shops. Patients should discuss their treatment with their doctor, and in that discussion, make sure they understand a lot about their cancer that they may have forgotten, or may their family may not have heard. What is their outlook from their cancer? What would their outlook be realistically without COVID-19? How important is the treatment? How important is it to have it now versus having a break or a reduction? Because cancer patients have had worse outcomes during COVID-19. That's been reported from China and Italy. And part of that will be because they're older. Some of them have many patients have other diseases as well. But part of it is because of the treatment, we think, and being immune suppressed. So if we can give patients a reprieve from their treatment, we are actually keeping them safer rather than denying them treatment. So there are some simple things that everyone should be doing in their home, but particularly important with cancer patients. We know the virus lives for a long time on surfaces, so wiping surfaces with disinfectant, constantly washing hands, getting used to not touching our face, and leaving windows open for ventilation, because this virus is carried by air in droplets, and that's now very well established. Going back to what clinicians should do with their patients, as a hospital or a department or a group of practitioners, certainly what we've done is go through all the treatments, try and make some broad principles, and then apply them to patients. We're seeing patients earlier by video conference to explain the changes to them. We're agreeing as a group perhaps to give a medication less frequently, unless there's an exception for an individual patient, so that there's not confusion when multiple doctors are doing different things within a service. We're involving our pharmacists, of course, and nurses with those decisions. So in my hospital, we've actually had a project of where we usually write up all the chemotherapy each week, flagging each patient where we thought there could be an alternative, going back and asking that patient's clinician to review, perhaps do a scan a little bit earlier than they would to see if they're responding or not in this little window before the hospitals become overrun, if that is what will happen. And also, very importantly, documenting in the medical records and in letters what the underlying prognosis of the patient is, how we expect them to go independent of COVID, to clearly make the difference between someone who's having adjuvant therapy or is curative therapy versus someone who's having palliative therapy. We are now used to, because our treatments have improved for many things, keeping patients alive for a lot longer. But still, when you look at the underlying prognosis in the context of COVID, and if there is any sort of rationalization or prioritization of healthcare, we will have to admit that a large number of our patients have a limited prognosis. So that's something that not only do healthcare professionals need to recognise and get right for each patient, obviously within their best judgment, but we also need to let patients and their families know that that may be a consideration, and that, you know, a realistic understanding of patient prognosis independent of COVID is what is sometimes avoided or watered down because we don't like giving bad news, or we hope our patient is the one patient who defies the odds. But in a time like this, it's very, very important to have the patient understand that and the documentation so the clinical staff understand that as well.
Yes, that sounds sensible. It's that communication is going to be incredibly key, especially if further down the track people are hospitalised, and as you said, they need to communicate clearly with the emergency team who might be treating them what their health concerns and prognosis is.
In the countries where the health services have been overwhelmed, not every patient who gets COVID goes to hospital, and not every patient who gets non-COVID disease, so worsening of their underlying cancer, can go to hospital. So these things really are very critical. The other thing I would say to clinicians is we don't know how COVID would impact our patients, but we know that it's devastating on a normal population, and it really is something we haven't encountered before, having this enormous competing risk of death. But we have gone through, as I've said, at our institution, and there are a lot of ways we can change patients' treatment to potentially make it safer and to reduce their visits to the hospital.
I'd like to ask you about COVID and how you think it may affect more vulnerable patient groups. I'm thinking particularly about Indigenous Australians, who we know already experience a higher burden of both cancer and infectious disease.
Yes, Indigenous patients have well documented poorer outcomes from cancer stage by stage. They have more comorbidities generally. This is not just the Australian Indigenous community. These are Indigenous communities around the world. They often live in more regional or remote locations, so access to care is also an issue. We're very, very concerned in Australia about COVID getting into Indigenous communities. And those people with cancer, Indigenous patients, are particularly vulnerable. One of the dilemmas that will come up, because many Indigenous patients and remote patients have to move to become more regional or closer to a bigger centre to get their treatment, that they again may expose themselves to more risk of COVID by doing that. On the other hand, if they remain remote, they may not be able to get their cancer treatment. And as good as telehealth is, we're only as good as the network. And, you know, when the network goes down, we can't communicate anymore. So I think there's enormous challenges there. And, of course, the best thing is if COVID doesn't get into these communities. We need to just keep looking after these people as best we can, recognise the vulnerabilities, and again, make changes now that might reduce their risk. If we can do that without impacting too much on their outcome, that will really benefit patients. If we keep going saying cancer is the most important and this patient really needs this chemotherapy, and yet the patient is on palliative treatment, not first line, a little frail, we probably are not doing them any favours.
I think those communication challenges are going to be difficult as well. Going back to technology, I'd actually like to talk a little bit about clinical trials and if you think things will change in the future because of the experiences that we will go through during this pandemic of utilising telehealth more.
So there's a number of aspects again to that question. One is about continuing with trials during the pandemic and all the issues to do with that. And again, the principle is if the treatment is warranted, if the patient would be on treatment anyway off the clinical trial, and if the treatment does not pose particular danger to the patient in terms of COVID, in other words, doesn't make them profoundly immune suppressed or some other aspect, then by and large, the principles are that clinical trials can continue. However, what has changed is the need to see patients in person every visit. Most trials have a compulsory examination every visit, every 2 weeks. That's been in there forever. And you know, has always been a challenge to do a complete physical examination on the patient every 2 weeks, but that's nevertheless, or 3 weeks, most trials require that. All of those things have had to be modified because of COVID. Consent is still required in person, but if it's witnessed by video conference, I think that may change. And the whole culture of clinical trials has been very much person to person, everything in the room. And I think a legacy of this pandemic is that we will adapt more to teletrials and to less intense processes where you require lots of people in the room together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does bring me actually nicely to a workforce question, which I have. In the UK and countries like Spain and Italy, we've seen a lot of retired staff returning to the hospitals, and we've seen medical staff being reassigned from their usual departments to assist. Do you envisage something similar happening in Australia?
So we've just heard a whole lot of retired doctors and nurses have been called up. Hopefully they're not elderly. Hopefully they retired and went into banking or some other profession and they're still young. But if, you know, they won't be put in danger. So they may backfill those of us who are actively practicing. Certainly in our hospital, once capacity becomes an issue, all the subspecialty physician teams will be dissolved and we will come into general medicine teams. And our training really is as a physician. Now, people have had various experiences along the way. I've got one staff member who is fairly junior and he had a lot of intensive care experience in his training. And so he may well be repurposed. But it's with his consent. Hospitals are drawing up skills matrices of staff and they have plans for repurposing, but everyone will retain the right to say that they don't feel comfortable doing something. What is scary are the reports from overseas where people are just so overwhelmed and so much wanting to try and help people that they do that without enough PPE, personal protective equipment. And so there is a lot of angst and concern in Australia about whether we have adequate PPE. And there is a relation to the cancer patient in that there's been no specific recommendations different for cancer or other immune suppressed patients in terms of PPE than there have been for non-immune suppressed patients. Now, no one knows if that's correct or not, but it's certainly being hotly debated. We've canvassed for separate fever clinics for immune suppressed patients. Obviously, that can only be done in centres where there's a larger volume. We've trying to put a different pathway in ED for immune compromised patients. Then you have to subdivide further if you have an immunocompromised COVID patient. So all of these are being worked out at systems level so that at least we can use the weeks or months advantage that we have in being behind the Northern Hemisphere and getting some lessons from them.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think there's a big opportunity to learn, and having that advantage of time is certainly something we should take advantage of as best we can. I want to ask you about the future, actually. I know it's very hard to predict, but once the curve flattens and we have a greater understanding of Australia's experience with COVID, do you think there will be any positive outcomes?
I think it's always you're able to find some positive outcomes. In times of war, there's a lot of invention, there's a lot of willingness of society to change quickly and accept things that they wouldn't accept under other circumstances. You can see even from the enormous amount of work that's been done towards getting a vaccine, which is really the only way this pandemic will end globally. You can see that there's been enormous invention in people making ventilators, making hand sanitizers, gin factories, all sorts of, Gucci sewing masks, etc. I think keeping up people's morale is very important, but I think there will be changes in society and in healthcare and in oncology care that will streamline our processes, will sharpen our focus, and they will live on beyond the pandemic and I think ultimately be the good that comes out of this.
Yes, I agree. I think we are already becoming a lot more collaborative and kinder too. I think it is a great opportunity to think as a community. And definitely would like you to expand on patient morale. I think that's going to be really important, and for everyone, actually. Depression and anxiety, I think, will certainly affect a lot of people during this phase.
There's so many aspects to that, aren't there? Cancer patients are older. They may more likely, therefore, to not have a family with them. Some families are separating because they don't want to be close to the cancer patient, and particularly if you're a healthcare worker. So that makes the cancer patients more isolated. We have some very tech-savvy cancer patients. Patients are often familiar with using apps and websites and getting lots of different information, being on chats and various online support groups. But there's a large section of the population, and depends where you practice, where that isn't prevalent in cancer patients. And patients may, as I've said, not have the internet. They may not even have a mobile phone. They may live with another non-English speaking, so the whole household is non-English speaking, perhaps relying on family overseas. And again, that's been made a lot harder by the various restrictions. So I think there is a very high risk of in the community, and that's been well recognised, of the mental health effects of this lockdown or this social restriction. I think cancer patients face an even bigger challenge. As I've said, they're wondering about their treatment. They're wondering if they got COVID-19, whether they would be denied acceleration of care, they need intensive care. On the other hand, cancer patients have faced death or the concept of death. That's what comes with a cancer diagnosis. I'm not saying all cancer patients die, far from it, but they face their mortality at that time of diagnosis. And very pleasingly, many patients are cured. But they have had that experience where they've had an illness, where the very name brings out the fear of death. So in some ways, our patients have been there and confronted this before. I would encourage clinicians to talk to patients and encourage them to talk to their families. We all should be doing that. We all should be making our wills. We should all be telling each other our wishes. It sounds very, very gruesome. And the worst that can happen is we didn't need to have done that, and that would be the very best outcome. So I think we'll see a mixed reaction amongst the cancer population. I think there's a mixed understanding at this stage out there of patients about the disease. Some may have chosen not to look too far into what's happening overseas. There's a sort of surreal sense and a sense of disbelief. Probably clinicians are more aware of it because we're talking to our friends and colleagues overseas. We're reading all the literature is almost entirely COVID. That may not be the situation for our patients. And certainly the governments concentrate a lot on the economy and business, which is very important as well, obviously, but perhaps not quite as confronting. So we need to use the resources. There are all sorts of groups coming together, trying to share resources to make sure we're all giving the same message, because that's the other danger. There's a lot of mixed messaging going around. And we really, I think, an enormous way even in 2 weeks. And the next 2 weeks we'll travel a lot further in that information and communication field.
Yes, absolutely. And of course, after another couple of weeks, I think we'll have a much clearer picture of how things are going to travel, and data to compare with the other countries in the Northern Hemisphere that are already that 2 weeks, a month ahead of us. Certainly going to be some interesting times, and we will adapt. And I absolutely agree. I think communication is going to be the key between healthcare professionals and with patients as well, just to really minimize that mixed messaging and try and address confusion, because I think that would probably affect morale in a very great way, and play on people's fears when they're hearing something from somewhere and something from something else, and it's contradictory. And we need to try and be as clear as possible for everybody, so that we can get through this.
That is a challenge, because you know, cancer patients and doctors are used to dealing with uncertainty, but this is just a whole other level. And this involves the general community being uncertain, the experts being uncertain. And so we can't be too dogmatic. We do have to be very flexible. We're learning as we go. But we can always assure patients that we're here for them and here to give them the best possible care. The message, though, is that the care needs to be, what we're doing for them needs to be reevaluated to try and keep them safe.
Mm-hmm. And so that would be your key take-home message, I think, for healthcare professionals, is just that need to reassess and revisit treatment plans and medications, as you said, working with the pharmacy teams.
Yes, and visits to the hospital. And we need to work and advocate for governments so that we can get changes to things like the PBS regulations that restrict us from giving drugs that may be oral or may be able to be given at home. So we really need to advocate as well for our patients that we have got the full flexibility I'm not calling for open slather, give any care you like. We still need to obviously practice evidence-based medicine, but we're in a different scenario. So we are trading off risks like coming to the hospital, even sending patients out for blood tests and scans. And if we're able to advocate with government that we have more options at our fingertips without the heavy PBS restriction, without the inability to give subcutaneous drugs because there's no funding for the nurse who goes to give them at home, all of those things can help. So we need to look after our individual patients, modify their treatment, work with our colleagues, support our colleagues, share information, and also advocate for our patients because they are a special group in the community who need extra care at this time.
Wonderful. Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much, Eva, for your very valuable time. I know you're very busy at the moment preparing for what is to come. And so I'm very grateful for your time and for sharing these insights with us. And I hope our listeners, and I'm sure they will get a lot of value from it as well. So thank you very much. We really appreciate it.
Pleasure. Thank you.
You've been listening to the Oncology Podcast. If you enjoyed today's edition and would like to subscribe, head over to our website, oncologynews.com.au, and subscribe to our newsletter for weekly podcast updates and a review of the oncology news from Australia and around the world. Thank you for listening.